Good morning. The first item of business is general questions, and as ever, I would appreciate succinct questions and answers to match. And with that, at question number one, I call Daniel Johnson.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on how it is ensuring that those awarded public sector contracts and grants meet its Fair Work First requirements, including the payment of the real living wage.
Minister Tom Arthur.
For public sector grants, as stated in the Fair Work First guidance, monitoring compliance with Fair Work First principles, including the real living wage and effective voice conditions, is the responsibility of the individual grant managers across government and of relevant funders across the wider public sector. It will be part of existing grant governance, assurance and monitoring processes, as with any other condition of grant, such as agreed outcomes. For public sector contracts, as stated in the practical guidance on Fair Work First and procurement, the terms and conditions of the contract and the approach to contract and supplier management should be agreed with the winning bidder. This helps ensure that any commitment to the Fair Work First criteria offered by the winning bidder is adopted and complied with for the duration of the contract.
Daniel Johnson.
Can I thank the Minister for that very detailed answer? Hopefully he is aware that the Police Scotland's facilities contractor is OSC. According to the GMB, they are failing to pay workers the real living wage, which is a key requirement of the Fair Work guidance. Now, the Government has aspirations for Scotland to become a Fair Work nation by next year, but so far this is a clear example of a public sector contract failing to comply with that framework. So can I ask the Minister, who is accountable for ensuring Fair Work conditions are met, what is the remedy for non-compliance, and how will they ensure that every single contract across the public sector, across all organisations, is compliant with Fair Work principles and the Fair Work framework?
Minister.
Well, thank Mr Johnson for the supplementary question, as I'm sure he appreciates that given the contractual relationship is between the Scottish Police Authority and OCS, it would not be appropriate for the Scottish Government to directly intervene and comment on these matters. However, I can confirm that the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs discussed this issue with the Chair of the Scottish Police Authority in November 2023 and received assurances that the SPA was content with the actions of Italian Servest and had taken to address any outstanding issues with their staff and that they were paying the living wage to their employees. I appreciate this is a matter of interest. I am new in post and I will be keen to engage with Mr Johnson and other opposition spokespeople on this issue as we go forward.
Question number two, Richard Leonard.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I remind members of my voluntary register of trade union interests to ask the Scottish Government what recent discussions it has had with the owners of the Grangemouth refinery, its workers, trade unions, regarding the future of the site?
Cabinet Secretary Mary McCann.
Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government continues to engage extensively on these matters. I most recently met with Petroenius yesterday, alongside UK Government ministers from the Department of Energy Security and from the Scotland Office. During this meeting, I made clear the Scottish Government's continued commitment to engage constructively with the business and our desire for all parties to cooperate on a sustainable future. I also had the chance yesterday at the All Energy Conference to meet with representatives of the company as well as RWE on their new green hydrogen plans that were announced yesterday. In respect of unions, ministers met with Unite the Union and with STUC on the morning of the import terminal announcement last year, and we've subsequently met several times, including in a Just Transition roundtable event that I held with unions on the 29th of February. Petroenius and the unions are also member of the Grangemouth Future Industry Board Leadership Forum that I most recently convened on the 28th of March, and I have a further meeting with Unite planned in the coming weeks.
Richard Leonard.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that reply? The UK sustainable aviation fuel mandate is due to commence in 2025. The mandate will apply to jet fuel suppliers. The Grangemouth refinery is a long-established and profitable supplier of aviation fuel. It is an ideal location for a future fuels hub. So will the Scottish Government work with the current owners, including PetroChina, and with the trade unions, especially Unite? Will it use its agencies like Scottish Enterprise, the Scottish National Investment Bank, the Just Transition Fund to realise this vision, to extend the life of the refinery and to plan and invest in a sustainable fuel future for these workers, this industry and this community?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I very much agree with much of what Richard Leonard has said. I would have said before, and I'll repeat, that my preference is that refining operations continue for as long as possible. But in the meantime, it's also my expectation and something that the Scottish Government is very much carrying out, that we work to maximise future opportunities at Grangemouth. I agree with Richard Leonard that sustainable aviation fuel and the production of it at Grangemouth is one of those future opportunities. We do have a situation where the regulatory framework around it, including the HEFA cap and consideration thereof post-Brexit, lies with UK Government. That's why I have been convening meetings, including the trilateral that I had yesterday, to take these matters forward.
Supplementary, Michelle Thompson.
Thank you. I note reference that the Cabinet Secretary has already referenced the German firm RWE. I wonder if she could briefly outline how their proposals for a hydrogen site in place of the refinery would help fulfil at least part of the Just Transition Plan of the Scottish Government.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, Michelle Thompson is absolutely right that as well as sustainable aviation fuel mentioned by Richard Leonard, the opportunities for fuel switching and for the production of hydrogen at Grangemouth are also future opportunities which we are exploring. I would repeat that I would welcome the announcement yesterday from RWE and with the company that they're taking forward together. And I would repeat that these are multifaceted issues where responsibilities lie with the company, with a regulatory framework, with the UK Government, and of course the Scottish Government plays its part as well. And I'm determined through all of the fora that I've discussed today to continue pursuing that.
And supplementary, Stephen Kerr.
Thank you. At the beginning of March, the Grangemouth Future Industry Board, and I quote, agreed to draft an action plan outlining activities that the board can deliver within the next 100 days. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary who is responsible for delivering the plan and when will it be published?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I chaired my first meeting of the Grangemouth Future Industry Board Leadership Forum very recently, where these matters were discussed. My officials and I are now taking them forward. For the Chamber's interest, there is a wide spectrum of membership on that board: Scottish Government, UK Government, local colleges, local authorities, the companies and others. So we're working together on the production of documents just now, and I'm happy to update the Chamber when I have the next date for the meeting.
Question number three, Paul O'Kane.
To ask the Scottish Government when it last met with NHS, Greater Glasgow and Clyde.
Cabinet Secretary Neil Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Ministers and Scottish Government officials regularly meet with representatives of all health boards, including NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde, to discuss matters of importance to local people.
Paul O'Kane.
Earlier this month, Greater Glasgow and Clyde Health Board approved the permanent downgrading and reduction of the out-of-hours GP service in Inverclyde, now the only part of the board not to have a full service. This was despite widespread opposition in the public consultation and the unanimous opposition of Inverclyde Council. And whilst local SNP parliamentarians have tried to excuse the cuts, reports to the board have made clear there has been a lack of investment in frontline services, including out-of-hours services, and the Director of Finance for the board has said that they will have to review every line of spend in order to meet their savings target. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, why did the Scottish Government refuse to call in this decision in the face of that widespread opposition? And will he be yet another SNP Health Secretary who comes to Inverclyde and tells people that services are safe with this government and then presides over cuts, closures and second-tier provision?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I thank Paul O'Kane for his question. Of course, I recognise the strong feeling that is held within the local area on the matter. Obviously, it is a decision for the board to make, but I obviously expect services to be provided safely, sustainably and as close as possible to where local people need them. Paul O'Kane is right. There was significant engagement that took place across the board, approximately 40 activities across the region, including 4 public drop-in sessions in Inverclyde. The possibility of offering a 7-day service in Inverclyde was explored, but the board was clear that in the view of the small patient numbers from Monday to Friday, which was an average of 4 patients in a 14-hour period, this could not be sustained. So the board has also agreed to offer patient transport to all Inverclyde patients who need to receive care at a primary care emergency centre out with these times. Of course, on the financial front, the Scottish Scottish Government has protected health spending as far as we possibly can in the face of a declining UK Government block grant. We've provided a record level of funding, including a 3% real terms increase to all NHS boards, though I do recognise the challenges that exist in spite of that due to increased pressure.
Question number 4, Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what recent discussions it has had with Renfrewshire Council regarding the timetable for the joining up of the sections that will form the Renfrew Bridge, which will cross the Clyde at Yoker.
Minister Tom Arthur.
Our role in the project is as a funder through the Glasgow City Region deal. We have committed £500 million to the deal, of which £39 million is towards the new bridge that will connect Renfrew with Clydebank and Yoker. The latest update at the most recent meeting on 17 April between officials and the Regional Programme Office was that construction is scheduled to be completed in August. As the project is led by Renfrewshire Council, further details are not held centrally and the Council would be best placed to pursue further information.
Bill Kidd.
Thanks very much to the Minister. As you say, the Glasgow City Region deal has been central to the success of this project as it nears its 10th anniversary. Can the Minister say how the Government intends to build upon this and other successful projects undertaken as part of the City deal through new initiatives such as the Clyde Mission?
Minister.
Indeed, we are committed to working constructively and in partnership with local authorities, regional economic partners and indeed wider Civic Scotland to ensure that we are providing that support to build on the legacy of the City deal. Indeed, the City deal is delivering significant benefits to Glasgow City specifically and the wider area with the partnership authorities. In my responsibilities as Minister for Investment, I'm committed to engaging with partners and be more than happy to meet with Mr Kidd to discuss what further opportunities there are to work collaboratively.
And supplementary, Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It's approaching the 10th anniversary of the Glasgow City Region deal being announced, and it's good to see that the bridge is nearing completion. But will the Minister confirm if the bridge has been designed at least with the idea of integration with Clyde Metro in the future so that it can take light rail infrastructure?
Minister.
I appreciate Mr Sweeney's supplementary question and his long-standing interest in these areas. I'm not in a position to give him a specific and detailed answer, but I would be more than happy to write to the member to provide further information and indeed to meet with him to discuss these matters further.
Question number 5, Ross McCall.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it can take to ensure that tourism is inclusive and accessible for all.
Minister Tom Arthur.
Our vision for a fairer Scotland means that everyone should be able to benefit from our vibrant visitor economy. Scotland Outlook 2030, the national tourism strategy, includes a commitment to ensure Scotland is an inclusive and accessible destination. Equality, diversity and inclusion are threaded through all the missions of our tourism and hospitality industry leadership group. Our national tourism organisation, Visit Scotland, focuses on inclusive tourism as a key strand of its responsible tourism strategy. This includes publishing an inclusive tourism toolkit with tips and support to help individual businesses ensure they are inclusive and welcoming to all.
Ross McCall.
Thank you. I thank you for that answer, but given that 4 out of 5 disabled people do not have a holiday of any kind, primarily due to the limited number of holiday venues that can accommodate the additional needs, well, I recently visited the Rings and Cooper in my region to see for myself the wonderful, fully accessible accommodation providing hospitality for all, and I was surprised at how simple and unobtrusive many of the alterations were. So will the Scottish Government agree to look at various legislative obstacles, including planning, as to how to ensure hospitality and tourism will be fully accessible in Scotland?
Minister.
Yes, I'd be more than happy to commit to that, and I'm very grateful to the member for bringing this important issue to the chamber. I would reiterate we want to ensure that everyone in Scotland has an opportunity to enjoy our world-class visitor economy. So in that spirit, I'd be more than happy to meet with the member and any other members to discuss these matters further.
And supplementary, Christine Graham.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Can I ask the Minister if he will visit Gala Shields in the heart of my constituencies to see the significant measures in place on public transport, both bus and train, and indeed improvement to pavements to increase accessibility to tourist destinations such as the Great Tapestry of Scotland for those with challenges into their mobility, something I'm learning to my own cost, I hope temporarily.
Minister.
Yes, I'd be delighted to. I commend Christine Graham for raising these matters and also commend her in securing what I think is her third or fourth ministerial visit from myself since I was first appointed.
Question number 6 has been withdrawn. Question number 7, Colleen McNeill.
To ask the Scottish Government what discussions it's had with Glasgow City Council and representatives of the taxi trade in light of reports of potentially significant job losses in the sector as a result of the implementation of the low emission zone.
Cabinet Secretary Fiona Hislop.
Scottish Government officials have met frequently with both Glasgow City Council officials and representatives of the taxi trade to discuss the rates of taxi low emission zone compliance. Glasgow City Council are responsible for administration and enforcement of their LEZ and may grant local time-limited exemptions where appropriate. From June 2023, a 12-month extension was offered to any Glasgow taxi operators with non-compliant vehicles, and Glasgow City Council have recently announced they will offer a further extension to the exemption for some taxis beyond June 2024, where taxi operators can demonstrate a commitment to retrofit or purchase compliant replacement vehicles.
Polly McNeill.
Thank you. In answer to a question from Annie Wells last week, the Cabinet Secretary said, unlike major cities in Scotland, Glasgow City Council does not have an age limit on taxis, so there's a higher proportion of older taxis. But what I'd like to raise with the Cabinet Secretary is that in a recent meeting of taxi drivers in the city, as older workers with older vehicles, they are unable to finance a new vehicle and ineligible for a grant for Glasgow City Council. There are actually hundreds of older drivers in the situation, so the City Council have offered them no options at all, and they're going to be forced out of business, as you're talking about up to 300 licences. So I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary would agree with me that it's unfair to older drivers who do not have an option, and they're very experienced drivers, not only a loss to the city, but indirectly, perhaps it might be considered as discrimination against older drivers if a further exemption is not granted.
Cabinet Secretary.
So I think the member is correct to look at the different experiences in different cities. For Dundee, for example, the taxi compliance is already 90%, Aberdeen 75%, but Glasgow, that has been running longer, is down at 63%. In terms of the finances available, we have recently announced further retrofitting funding that's available for those that want to apply. It's not necessary to purchase a new cab to meet those entry standards. The retrofitting costs after grant are typically £2,500 to £4,000, or alternatively, purchase of a second-hand Euro 6 taxi that is up to 8 years old and can still meet LEZ standards. She raises an important point, but obviously somebody facing retirement may want to sell on their taxi, and clearly one that has been retrofitted will have more of a value than one that hasn't been. So I think there's something there, particularly with lenders, to look very sensitively, as well as the government-supported retrofitting fund.
Question number 8, Katie Clark.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the redevelopment of Ardrossan Harbour.
Cabinet Secretary.
The essential business case and cost review work is now nearing completion, and I expect to give a further update on this project before summer recess. This work has been vital to provide clarity on the scope, benefits and potential costs of the project, as well as update the investment requirements from the main funding partners. A meeting of the Ardrossan Harbour Task Force is planned for later this afternoon, with the business case review work expected with ministers for consideration thereafter.
Katie Clark.
CalMAC have said that it is the failure of port owners Peel to invest that has left the harbour in substandard condition, despite the owners receiving over £15 million in harbour dues over the last decade. And given the long-standing issues, there have been repeated calls to bring the port into public ownership. Does this Cabinet Secretary accept the current situation is unacceptable? Will she confirm the Scottish Government's commitment to address and outline her strategy? And given that there hasn't been a meeting of the task force since March 2023, and there's due to be one later today, will she come back to this chamber with a statement to outline the government's approach?
Cabinet Secretary.
I've already said that I will provide an update before summer recess. That's the plans. Our focus is on ensuring a robust business case can be developed to ensure that the case for Ardrossan can be properly considered and the cost and scope well understood so investment decisions can be made. And regardless of ownership, it is important that any operational issues are addressed by both parties, CalMAC and Peel Ports Group, to resolve them quickly to ensure minimal impact and disruption to the services to island communities. Any purchase would, of course, depend on an owner willing to sell.